First reaction we have already considered, nucleophilic substitution reactions. And the second reaction I am going to consider now is a dehydrohalogenation reaction. To understand this reaction, I will consider the example of ethyl bromide. Ethyl bromide, I'll represent it like this. Ethyl bromide. I'm going to make use of alcoholic KOH as the reagent. I need to heat it. And during this reaction, hydrogen will go from beta carbon atom and halogen will go from alpha carbon atom. HBr is removed. HBr is acidic in nature. It is formed in the presence of base. Neutralization reaction takes place. It forms salt and water. So, you get potassium bromide and water. So, products I will write here, KBr plus H2O. Once hydrogen and bromine are removed, to satisfy tetravalency on these two carbon atoms, the single bond gets converted into double bond. So, the major product obtained is CH2. Double bond CH2, it is ethene. So, if I summarize it, what should be the substrate? Should be alkyl halide. What is a reagent? It has to be alcoholic potash. This is important. It has to be alcoholic potash. If it happens to be aqueous KOH, substitution reaction takes place. And Br group will be replaced by OH group, forming ethanol. What is the reaction condition? One has to heat it. How does the reaction take place? Hydrogen gets removed from beta carbon atom. Halogen is removed from alpha carbon atom. And what will be the product? Alkene will be the product. Let us consider dehydrohalogenation reaction on 2-bromopentane. In 2-bromopentane, so this is 2-bromopentane. You can make out that this is alpha carbon atom and the immediately next carbon atoms are called beta carbon atoms. So in this molecule there are 2 beta carbon atoms, hence we come across 2 types of beta hydrogens. Now I want to carry out dehydrohalogenation reaction. I'll make use of alcoholic potash. And I will heat it. So dehydrohalogenation can take place in 2 different ways. In the first case, I consider removal of halogen atom from alpha carbon atom and removal of hydrogen from this beta carbon atom. As a result, double bond gets introduced over here. What will be the product? It has to be CH3, then it is a CH double bond CH, and here I'll have CH2 CH3. On the other hand, if beta hydrogen is removed from this carbon atom, double bond gets introduced over here and the product obtained would be CH2 double bond CH. It is CH2, CH2, CH3. So two different major products are possible. The first one is pent-2-ene. This is pent-1-ene. And when you find out the percentage yield, it's observed that pent-2-ene is formed to an extent 81% and pent-1-ene is formed to an extent 19%. Or in other words, the major product is pent-2-ene. If I observe these two products, you can make out that pent-2-ene is more substituted. What way I can say it is more substituted? Consider the two doubly bonded carbon atoms here. I'll represent it like this. And if you have an unsubstituted alkene on each doubly bonded carbon atoms, I must have two hydrogens like this. If suppose only one hydrogen is substituted by R group, so substitution has taken place to an extent 1. If suppose this hydrogen is replaced, substitution has taken place to an extent 2. Here, 3 and 4. When I consider this particular case, you can make out that, you know, on two doubly bonded carbon atoms, we have two hydrogens, and other two hydrogens are replaced by one methyl group here and the other one is ethyl group. So how many substitutions have taken place here? Two substitutions have taken place. On the other hand, if I come to this particular product, this is the doubly bonded carbon atoms. These are the doubly bonded carbon atoms. So I repeat. We shall start from the other chemical reactions of haloalkanes. The first reaction we have already considered was nucleophilic substitution reactions. The second reaction I am going to consider is dehydrohalogenation reaction. We shall start from chemical reactions of haloalkanes. Already first type of chemical reactions you have studied, nucleophilic substitution reactions. The second type of reaction I am going to consider is dehydrohalogenation. In order to understand this reaction, I am going to start from ethyl bromide. In ethyl bromide, the carbon atom to which halogen atom is attached is alpha carbon atom. The next carbon atom will be beta carbon atom. So the starting substance is ethyl bromide. I am going to heat it with alcoholic potash. The word alcoholic is very important. The reaction condition is I have to heat it. What happens is halogen atom gets removed from alpha carbon atom, hydrogen atom gets removed from beta carbon atom. So in between alpha and beta carbon atom, a double bond gets introduced to maintain the tetravalency of both the carbon atoms. That's why the major product obtained is CH2 double bond CH2. It is ethene. What about the byproducts formed? You know, from here HBr is removed, which is acidic in nature. It is formed in the presence of base KOH. Neutralization reaction must take place between KOH and HBr. Products formed must be salt and water. So what will be the salt? Potassium bromide. Along with that, water is formed. So in dehydrohalogenation reaction, the substrate is alkyl halide. The reagent is very important. It has to be alcoholic potash. The word alcohol has to be there, because if this happens to be aqueous KOH, substitution reaction takes place where Br group will be replaced by OH group. So as a result, the product that you would get will be ethyl alcohol. That's why the reagent must be mentioned as alcoholic potash. Reaction condition, you have to heat it. How does reaction take place? Halogen atom is removed from alpha carbon atom. Hydrogen atom is removed from beta carbon atom. And in between alpha and beta carbon atom, double bond gets introduced. Let us consider dehydrohalogenation on 2-bromopentane. In this molecule, you can observe that there are two different types of beta hydrogens. When you carry out dehydrohalogenation using alcoholic KOH, you get two different products depending on which beta hydrogen atom is removed. If hydrogen is removed from this beta carbon atom, you will get double bond over here. On the other hand, if hydrogen is removed from this beta carbon atom, you will get double bond here. So depending on which beta hydrogen atom is removed, two products are possible. So which are the products? In the first case, I'll assume that hydrogen is removed from this beta carbon atom. The product obtained is CH3 CH double bond CH CH2 CH3. It is called pent-2-ene. And yield obtained is found to be 81%. If hydrogen is removed from this beta carbon atom, you will get a double bond here, and the product would be 1-pentene, the structure of which is written like this. And if you find out the percentage yield of this, it is found to be 19%. Or in other words, the major product is pent-2-ene. Now the question is, why pent-2-ene is the major product? In order to understand that, let us compare the extent of substitution in these two molecules. I am going to consider the substitutions taking place on doubly bonded carbon atoms. So I'll consider these two doubly bonded carbon atoms. I'll represent it like this, C double bond C. On this carbon atom, you have one hydrogen. And on this carbon atom, you have one hydrogen. On the second carbon atom, you have CH3 group attached. On this carbon atom, ethyl group is attached. In other words, if you consider the structure of pent-2-ene, there are two substitutions that have taken place on two doubly bonded carbon atoms. If I consider the structure of pent-1-ene, again I'll write the structure here, C double bond C. You can make out that on this doubly bonded carbon atom, we have two hydrogens. On the other doubly bonded carbon atom, I have one hydrogen, and other valency is satisfied by N-propyl group. So I'll write it as N-CH2 twice CH3. So if you look at the structure of pent-1-ene, there is only one substitution that has taken place on doubly bonded carbon atoms. Or in other words, in pent 2 in, the substitution has taken place to a greater extent compared to that in pent 1 in. And last year, under hydrocarbon, under hyperconjugation, you might have already studied that highly substituted alkene is always more stable. That's why that will be formed as a major product. So, how to state Sage-Jeff rule then? During dehydrohalogenation of an alkyl halide, if more than one alkene is possible, the one which is highly substituted, being more stable, is the preferred product. This is the statement of Sage-Jeff rule. The next reaction I am going to consider is reaction of haloalkanes with metals. The metal I am going to consider in the first case is magnesium. The product will be the Grignard reagents. I will consider alkyl halide as RX. I'll treat it with magnesium ribbon. And the reaction is carried out in the presence of dry and alcohol-free ether. You have to reflux the reactant mixture. Magnesium gets inserted in between R and X. What we get is RMgX. This reaction not only takes place with alkyl halide, also takes place with aryl halide. In other words, in this product, R can be alkyl group or it can be aryl group. In short, I can say these products are organomagnesium halides. And these organomagnesium halides are called what are known as Grignard reagents. So how to get Grignard reagent? When an alkyl halide or aryl halide is refluxed with magnesium ribbon in presence of dry and alcohol-free ether, we get organomagnesium halide, which are called Grignard reagents. Now let us study about the polarity of Grignard reagent. We have R single bond MgX. You know that there is very high difference in electronegativity values of magnesium and halogen. That's why the bond between magnesium and halogen is ionic in nature. On the other hand, if you consider the bond between R and Mg, Mg is a metal. When I say R, you will have carbon. So there is a considerable electronegativity difference, but it is not sufficient enough for the bond to be ionic. Or in other words, I can say that R-Mg bond is highly polar covalent bond. And you know that carbon atom is more electronegative than magnesium. That's why magnesium acquires partial positive charge and carbon acquires partial negative charge. Or in other words, if you consider the bond between R and Mg, it is highly polar covalent bond. Now, the question is, during the formation of Grignard reagent, or when Grignard reagent is used in any organic reaction, whatever ether you use as a solvent should be dry and alcohol free. What is the reason for that? Grignard reagent, I am going to consider as RMgX. Polarity you are already aware of. An R is a partial negative charge, magnesium partial positive charge. I am going to treat it with compounds containing active hydrogens. Best example is, let us say, water. In this case, hydrogen atom is attached to smaller and highly electronegative atom like oxygen. So this is an example for compound containing active hydrogen. Again, go for the polarity. Hydrogen will have partial positive charge, OH will have partial negative charge. So the product obtained would be partially positive hydrogen gets connected with partially negative R group. Product obtained is RH, hydrocarbon. Meanwhile, MgX, the positive part, gets connected with negative part OH. Product obtained is MgOHX. So, if suppose moisture is present in the ether, whatever Grignard reagent you are using or Grignard reagent form will immediately get converted into corresponding hydrocarbon. In the same way, I can consider other compounds containing active hydrogen, like for example, alcohol. I have represented alcohol as HOR. The same way the reaction takes place, the product obtained in this case will be RH and MgORX. I can also consider the reaction with ammonia and ammonia derivatives. Again, they are compounds containing active hydrogen. Go with the polarity in the same way. Delta plus, here is delta minus. So product obtained would be RH plus MgNH2X. So from these reactions, it's very clear that when you use a Grignard reagent or when Grignard reagent is formed, compounds containing active hydrogen must not be present. If they are present, we get the respective hydrocarbons. Under reaction with metals, the next reaction we consider is Wood's reaction. You have studied about Wood's reaction in grade 11. If you start from alkyl halide RX, the metal used here is a sodium metal. Two molecules of alkyl halide will undergo reaction. Reaction is carried out in presence of dry ether as a solvent. So from haloalkanes, X will get removed along with sodium. Byproduct formed is 2 moles of NaX, and the major product would be R single bond R. Or in other words, if I start from alkyl halide, the product obtained will be higher alkane. For example, if I start from ethyl bromide C2H5Br and carry out Wood's reaction, the product obtained will be N-butane. The formula of N-butane is CH3, CH2, CH2 and CH3. The byproduct formed is 2 moles of sodium bromide. So the major product obtained here is N-butane. Since the number of carbon atoms in the final product will be 2 times the number of carbon atoms present in the starting alkyl halide, we use the word higher alkane. Under this Oates reaction, we have to check if we make use of 2 different alkyl halides, how many products we are going to get. Let us say I will consider methyl bromide and ethyl bromide. When I treat them with sodium metal in presence of dry ether, I can get 3 different alkanes. What way I can get 3 different alkanes? First, one molecule of methyl bromide reacts with another molecule of methyl bromide, and the product obtained is CH3 single bond CH3 ethane. In the second case, one molecule of ethyl bromide reacts with another molecule of ethyl bromide, gives you C2H5, or in other words, it is N-butane. And the third possibility is one molecule of methyl bromide reacts with another molecule of ethyl bromide. It results in the formation of this compound C2H5CH3, or if you combine it and write it, it becomes N-propane. It becomes propane. So the products obtained are ethane, propane and N-butane. So how many alkanes you get in the product mixture? We get 3 alkanes. And this concept is generally tested in competitive examination. And also in some competitive examination, they will give you the product of Oates reaction and they will ask you to find out what should be the starting substance. For example, the product of Oates reaction is (2, 3)-dimethylbutane. And if you want to know what should be the starting substance in the Oates reaction, we have to bisect the molecule symmetrically. So how can I bisect it? Here, if I pass a plane, the molecule is bisected. Now, when the molecule is cleaved, I get these species. And here you will have unsatisfied valency. So that has to be satisfied by any halogen. In general, I am going to denote it as X. So to get this product, the starting alkyl halide must be like this. And also it may so happen, this is a CET question, CH3CH3, and here you will have CH3. It is called isobutane. And here whatever we do, it is not possible to divide the molecule symmetrically. That's why what we do is we will cleave the bond at this point. So the starting substance in Oates reaction should be this. It is CH3CHX CH3, plus corresponding to this CH3, I will have XCH3. So this will be the starting substances.